let's look at the rejection region approach in z-tests for the population mean mu. Suppose we are sampling from a normally distributed population, and the population standard deviation sigma is known. In this scenario, to test the null hypothesis that the population mean mu is equal to some hypothesized value mu naught, we're going to use this test statistic. Sigma x bar here is the standard deviation of the sampling distribution of x bar, and that's equal to sigma over the square root of n, our sample size. If the null hypothesis is true, then this test statistic will have the standard normal distribution. Eventually, we're going to get a sample, and this test statistic is going to take on a value. And the rejection region approach will be one way of determining whether that value gives us significant evidence against the null hypothesis. The rejection region approach involves choosing a value for alpha, which we call the significance level of the test. Alpha is the probability of rejecting the null hypothesis if it is true. I'll talk about that in much more detail when I discuss type 1 and type 2 errors in another video. The appropriate choice of alpha depends on the problem at hand, but often people choose alpha to be 0.05. Then we're going to find the appropriate rejection region, which will depend on our choice of alpha and on the alternative hypothesis. We will then reject the null hypothesis in favor of the alternative hypothesis if the test statistic falls in the rejection region. Suppose we wish to test the null hypothesis that mu is equal to mu naught against the alternative hypothesis that it is not equal to mu naught, and we use the z test statistic described earlier. If the null hypothesis is true, this test statistic will have a standard normal distribution, which I've drawn out here. If this null hypothesis is true, then it's going to be very unlikely to get z values that are far out in the tails of the distribution. And so z values far out in the tails of the distribution give strong evidence against the null hypothesis. But how far out do those values have to be before we can reject the null hypothesis in favor of the alternative hypothesis? Because our alternative hypothesis is two-sided, we're going to take that alpha value and divide it by 2, splitting it evenly into the two tails. We are then going to find the value from the standard normal distribution that gives us an area of alpha over 2 to the right, and we're going to call that the critical value. And we're going to do the same thing over here on the left tail. It's the critical value because it separates the rejection region from the region where we do not reject the null hypothesis. So we are going to reject the null hypothesis if we get a value over here, or if we get a value over here. If we get a value in the middle, we're going to not reject the null hypothesis. For example, here we have the two-sided alternative with an alpha level of 0.05. So I'm going to divide 0.05 by 2, giving me 0.025, and split that evenly into these two tails. We can then use software or a standard normal table to find the z value with an area of 0.025 off to the right. That value is 1.96. The notation we sometimes use is that z.025 is 1.96, or in other words, the z value with 0.025 off to the right is 1.96. Since the standard normal distribution is symmetric about 0, it shouldn't be too tough to figure out that this value in the left tail is going to be -1.96. And where this leaves us in the end is that we are going to reject the null hypothesis in favor of the alternative if the z value we get in our sample is bigger than or equal to 1.96, or the z value is less than or equal to -1.96. If we keep the alpha level the same, but change the alternative hypothesis to mu being less than mu naught, then values of this test statistic that are in the left tail of the distribution give us evidence against the null in favor of that alternative. And so we are going to put our entire alpha level over here in this left tail. Using software or a standard normal table, we can find the z value that gives an area of 0.05 off to the left is -1.645. And so we are going to reject the null hypothesis if the z value in our sample is less than or equal to -1.645. And if our alternative hypothesis is that mu is greater than mu naught, then values of this test statistic in the right tail of the distribution give us evidence against that null hypothesis in favor of the alternative. And so for an alpha level of 0.05, we are going to reject the null hypothesis if the z value that we observe is greater than or equal to 1.645. Let's look at a few examples. If our alternative hypothesis is that mu is greater than mu naught and alpha is 0.10, we're going to put that entire 0.10 out in the right tail of the distribution. We can find the z value that makes that happen is 1.28. And so we can reject the null hypothesis in favor of this alternative at alpha of 0.1 if the z value that we observe is bigger than or equal to 1.28. But we observe this z value of 3.1, and 3.1 is out here. So we can reject the null hypothesis in favor of this alternative at an alpha level of 0.10. On the other hand, if our alternative is that mu is less than mu naught, and we had this alpha level of 0.01, then we would put that entire alpha in the left tail of the distribution, and we would have this area out here being 0.01, and we would find the z value that makes that happen, and that, rounded to two decimal places, is -2.33. So we will reject the null hypothesis if the z value that we observe is less than or equal to -2.33. If the z value that we observe is 2.6, which is out here somewhere, then we are going to not reject the null hypothesis. If our alternative hypothesis is two-sided at an alpha level of 0.05, then we're going to split that alpha evenly into the two tails. So 0.025 in this tail and 0.025 in this tail. And as we've seen previously, the z values that make that happen is 1.96 in the right tail and -1.96 in the left tail. In this case, we observed a z value of -14.5, which is way, 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 way out here in this left tail. And so we can reject the null hypothesis at alpha of 0.05. But in some ways, the rejection region approach with a fixed value of alpha is a little silly. Suppose we had this alternative hypothesis and an alpha level of 0.05. If we happen to get a z value of 1.6448, say, we would not reject the null hypothesis at 0.05. If, however, we got a z value of 1.6451, we would reject the null hypothesis at an alpha level of 0.05. The conclusions would be very, very different, even though these two z values are very, very close. Thus, they yield very, very similar evidence against the null hypothesis. Also, if we were to get a z value that was very huge, let's say we got a z value that was 17,819, well, we would reject the null hypothesis at alpha of 0.05. We have the same conclusions in these two situations, even though this one has a great deal more evidence against the null hypothesis, and we would essentially never see anything that big if the null hypothesis were true. So instead of the rejection region approach, many people, myself included, greatly prefer the p-value approach. The p-value is a measure of the strength of the evidence against the null hypothesis. And I look at that in much more detail in another video.